Today the carpenter's hands are nailed to a cross. The King of Kings is crowned with thorns and wears the purple robes of mockery. Today he sets us free, himself imprisoned on a tree. Today is God's Friday. We come in worship. King of glory, we adore you, our Savior and Lord. You suffered on the cross and gave your life as a ransom for many. We bless and thank you for the outpouring of your love and offer our worship today out of unspeakable gratitude. And God greets you with these words from Scripture. May grace, may mercy, and may peace be with you today and always from God our Father and Jesus the Christ, through the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit, now and always. Amen. O Christ, who forsook no one, but was forsaken by the closest of friends, and who committed no crime yet was sentenced to a criminal's death, we enter your presence in awe and adoration. On this day, centuries ago, you could have saved your life, but you refused to betray the purpose for which you had been born. You had come into the world to love God and neighbor as yourself, and when that love required you to shoulder a cross, you summoned the strength to bear it. Today, O Christ, as we sing and pray about the cross, teach us its meaning once again, and help us to take up our cross and follow you. Amen. I invite you to stand for What Wondrous Love.
Thank you.
The next day John saw Jesus coming toward him. John said, "Look, the Lamb of God. He takes away the sins of the world."
Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. I give my life for the sheep.
I have other sheep that are not in this flock here. I must bring them also. They will listen to my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. And the Father loves me because I give my life, and I give my life so that I can take it back again. No one takes it away from me. I give my own life freely. I have the right to give my life, and I have the right to take it back. This is what my Father commanded me to do." Good Friday really begins the evening before, with Jesus gathering with his disciples over their last meal together. It's not clear in the Gospels if this was meant to be the Passover meal, but there are a number of connections made to the Passover meal as Jesus serves. Jesus is in Jerusalem during this Passover week, and it's a very noisy place. Not only were crowds of pilgrims in town milling around in the temple courts, but large numbers of animals were being slaughtered for the sacrifices that the people had to make. Because the Passover was a pilgrimage feast, the streets and homes were extra crowded, and the lambs for the sacrifices were being brought into the city from the fields around places like Bethlehem, creating an ear-hurting clamor wherever you went, especially in the area around the temple. And people were busy on the Thursday slaughtering the lambs, many then putting some of the blood on the doorposts in memory of the first Passover. In a typical Hebrew home, the mother is busy preparing for the celebration. There is food to cook, a specific meal with many symbolic foods, reminding everyone of the taste of slavery and the taste of freedom, of the journey Israel went through due to unfaithfulness. But then there are the tastes of the promised land and of blessing. To begin the meal, the father leads a family around the table. And as they sit around the table, the youngest child is prompted to ask, "What does this ceremony mean to you?" The family and guests then hear the father or the grandfather tell the story of Israel's slavery in Egypt, of the plagues, of the meaning of the Passover lamb with blood on the doorposts of the house, and of God's great deliverance. And with all of this history and meaning in the Passover meal, we're better able to understand what John the Baptist is saying when he sees Jesus at the beginning of Jesus' ministry. John 1, we read, "The next day John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, 'Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.'" Passover lamb points us to God's protection, to his deliverance from slavery, not only physical slavery, but also our slavery to sin. This lamb reminds us that God remembers us. He hears our cries for help. He responds with salvation and guides us on our way through life, providing us with what we need. And this is a sacrificial lamb, a lamb whose blood protects the people from the anger and punishment of God. Just as Jesus' blood protects us from the anger of God towards our sin and washes our sin away. This is what we see at Calvary as Jesus hangs on the cross. Jesus has willingly, out of his love for us, become the sacrificial lamb for our sin, protecting us from the penalty for our sin. We see the people's cruelty toward Jesus, the intensity of his suffering, his willingness to endure it, and the sacrifice it involves. Sin brings pain and suffering. And this is all reflected on the cross. But on the cross, we see another image. There is the Lamb sacrificed for sin on the Day of Atonement. And this takes us back to the temple again. After the sacrifices had been made, the priests laid their hands on the scapegoat and sent him out into the wilderness, carrying the sins of the people. Jesus is also our scapegoat. Jesus is taken outside the city like the scapegoat with the sin of the people on himself, taking our sin out of God's sight and presence. And Jesus does this all to wash away our sin so that we can be right with our Father once again. Let us sing and stand, Lamb of God.
Let's pray. Holy God, we come to worship in the gathering shadows of Jesus' suffering and death. We come with his friends, the men and women who have followed him in every place and generation, to live once again this story of service and betrayal, of weakness and courage. We come to witness your love in action. Be with us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
It was almost time for the Jewish feast of unleavened bread, called the Passover feast. The leading priests and teachers of the law were trying to find a way to kill Jesus, but they were afraid of the people.
One of Jesus' 12 disciples was named Judas Iscariot. Satan entered Judas, and he went to the leading priests and some of the soldiers who guarded the temple. He talked to them about a way to give Jesus to them. They were pleased and promised to give Judas money. Judas agreed. Then he waited for the best time to turn Jesus over to them without the crowd knowing it.
Preparation of the Passover meal. The day of unleavened bread came. This was the day the Passover lambs had to be sacrificed. Jesus said to Peter and John, "Go and prepare the Passover meal for us to eat."
They asked, Where do you want us to prepare it?
Jesus said to them, Listen, after you go into the city, you'll see a man carrying a jar of water. Follow him into the house that he enters. Tell the person who owns that house, The teacher asks that you please show us the room where he and his followers may eat the Passover meal. Then he will show you a large room upstairs. This room is ready for you. Prepare the Passover meal there.
So Peter and John left. Everything happened as Jesus had said, so they prepared the Passover meal. The Lord's Supper. When the time came, Jesus and the apostles were sitting at the table. He said to them, I wanted very much to eat this Passover meal with you before I die. I will never eat another Passover meal until it is given its true meaning in the kingdom of God.
Then Jesus took a cup. He gave thanks to God for it and said, Take this cup and give it to everyone here. I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until God's kingdom comes. Then Jesus took some bread. He thanked God for it, broke it, and gave it to the apostles. Then Jesus said, This bread is my body that I'm giving for you. Do this to remember me. In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup and said, This cup shows the new agreement that God makes with us people. This new agreement begins with my blood, which is poured out for you.
Who will turn against Jesus? Jesus said, One of you will turn against me. His hand is by my hand on the table. The Son of Man will do what God has planned. But how terrible it will be for that man who gives the Son of Man to be killed.
And the apostles asked each other, Which one of us would do that to Jesus?
On this day, Christ, the Lamb of God, gave himself into the hands of those who would slay him. On this day, Christ gathered with his disciples in the upper room. On this day, Christ took a towel and washed his disciples' feet, giving us an example that we should do to others as he has done to us. On this day, Christ our God gave us this holy feast, that we who eat this bread and drink this cup may here proclaim his holy sacrifice and be partakers of his resurrection, and at the last day may reign with him in heaven. We give thanks to God the Father that our Savior, Jesus Christ, before he suffered, gave us this memorial of his sacrifice until he comes again. Whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The bread that we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup for which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. Congregation of Jesus Christ, the Lord has prepared his table for all those who love him and trust in him alone for their salvation. If you are truly sorry for your sins, sincerely believe in the Lord Jesus as your Savior, and desire to live in obedience to him as Lord, you are now invited to come with gladness to the table of the Lord. For these are the gifts of God, and they are for the people of God. I invite the elders to come up to serve you at this time. For those who prefer juice, juice is a light-colored ring in the center, and we also have gluten-free bread for those who would like gluten-free, and we just ask you to raise your hand, and Elder Henry will serve you the gluten-free. Go to serve the people. Has everyone been served who wishes to partake? The body of Christ was broken for the complete forgiveness of all our sin. So take, eat, remember and believe the body of Christ is broken for all our sin. The blood of Christ was shed for each and every one of you. So take, drink, remember and believe that the blood of Christ was shed for the complete forgiveness of all our sin.
Thank you.
God's suffering servant. Isaiah 52, verses 13 through 15. The Lord says, "See, my servant will act wisely. People will greatly honor and respect him."
Many people were shocked when they saw him. His appearance was so damaged, he did not look like a man. His form was changed so much, they could barely tell he was human.
But now he will sprinkle many people. Kings will be amazed and shut their mouths.
They will see the things they had not been told about my servant. They will understand the things they had not heard.
Every day the priests stand and do their religious service. Again and again they offer the same sacrifices, but those sacrifices can never take away sins. But Christ offered one sacrifice for sins, and it is good forever. Then he sat down at the right side of God, and now Christ waits there for his enemies to be put under his power. With one sacrifice, he made perfect forever those who are being made holy.
Isaiah 53, verse 1 through 3. Who would have believed what we have heard? Who saw the Lord's power in this?
He grew up like a small plant before the Lord. He was like a root growing in a dry land. He had no special beauty or form to make us notice him. There was nothing in his appearance to make us desire him.
He was hated and rejected by people. He had much pain and suffering. People would not even look at him. He was hated, and we didn't even notice him.
Shadow of arrest. Those who came to arrest Jesus were the leading priests, the soldiers who guarded the temple, and the Jewish elders. Jesus said to them, "Why did you come out here with swords and sticks? Do you think I'm a criminal? I was with you every day in the temple. Why didn't you try to arrest me there? But this is your time, the time when darkness rules."
Shadow of desertion. They arrested Jesus and took him away. They brought him into the house of the high priest. Peter followed them, but he did not go near Jesus. The soldiers started a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat together. Peter sat with them. A servant girl saw Peter sitting there near the light. She looked closely at Peter's face and said, "This man was also with him."
But Peter said, "This was not true." He said, "Girl, I don't know him."
A short time later, another person saw Peter and said, "You are also one of them."
But Peter said, "Man, I am not."
About an hour later, another man insisted, "It is true. This man was with him. He is from Galilee."
But Peter said, "Man, I don't know what you are talking about."
Immediately, while Peter was speaking, a rooster crowed. Then the Lord turned and looked straight at Peter, and Peter remembered what the Lord had said, "Before the rooster crows tonight, you will say three times that you do not know me." Then Peter went outside and cried with much pain in his heart.
The people laugh at Jesus. Some men were guarding Jesus. They made fun of him like this. They covered his eyes so that he could not see them. Then they hit him and said, "Prove that you are a prophet and tell us who hit you." The men said many cruel things to Jesus.
Isaiah 53, verses 4 through 6. But he took our suffering on him and felt our pain for us. We saw his suffering. We thought God was punishing him.
But he was wounded for the wrong things we did. He was crushed for the evil things we did. The punishment which made us well was given to him. And we are healed because of his wounds.
We all have wandered away like sheep. Each of us has gone his own way. But the Lord has put on him the true punishment for all the evil we have done.
Accusation. Governor Pilate questions Jesus. Then the whole group stood up and led Jesus to Pilate. They began to accuse Jesus. They told Pilate, "We caught this man telling things that were confusing our people. He says that we should not pay taxes to Caesar. He calls himself the Christ, a king." Pilate asked Jesus, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Yes, that is right." Pilate said to the leading priests and the people, "I find nothing wrong with this man."
Pilate called all the people together with the leading priests and the Jewish leaders. He said to them, "You brought this man to me. You said that he was making trouble among the people, but I have questioned him before all of you, and I have not found him guilty of the things you say. Also, Herod found nothing wrong with him. He sent him back to us. Look, he has done nothing for which he should die. So after I punish him, I will let him go free." Every year at the Passover feast, Pilate had to release one prisoner to the people.
But all the people shouted, "Kill him! Let Barabbas go free!" Barabbas was a man who was in prison because he started a riot in the city. He was guilty of murder. Pilate wanted to let Jesus go free, so he told this to the crowd. But they shouted again, "Kill him! Kill him on a cross!" A third time, Pilate said to them, "Why? What wrong has he done? I can find no reason to kill him, so I will have him punished and set him free."
But they continued to shout. They demanded that Jesus be killed on the cross. Their yelling became so loud that Pilate decided to give them what they wanted. They wanted Barabbas to go free, the man who was in jail for starting a riot and for murder. Pilate let Barabbas go free and gave Jesus to them to be killed.
Then the apostles asked each other, "Which one of us would do that to Jesus?"
Isaiah 53, verse 7. He was beaten down and punished, but he didn't say a word. He was like a lamb being led to be killed. He was quiet, as a sheep is quiet while its wool is being cut. He never opened his mouth.
There were also two criminals led out with Jesus to be killed. Jesus and the two criminals were taken to a place called the Skull. There the soldiers nailed Jesus to his cross. They also nailed the criminals to their crosses, one beside Jesus on the right, and the other beside Jesus on the left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they are doing."
The soldiers threw lots to decide who would get his clothes. The people stood there watching. The leaders made fun of Jesus. They said, "If he is God's chosen one, the Christ, then let him save himself. He saved other people, didn't he?"
Even the soldiers made fun of him. They came to Jesus and offered him some vinegar. They said, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." At the top of the cross, these words were written, "This is the King of the Jews."
One of the criminals began to shout insults at Jesus. "Aren't you the Christ? Then save yourself and save us too."
But the other criminal stopped him. He said, "You should fear God. You're getting the same punishment as he is. We are punished justly. We should die. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then this criminal said to Jesus, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom."
Then Jesus said to him, "Listen, what I say is true. Today you will be with me in paradise."
Isaiah 53, verses 8 and 9. Men took him away roughly and unfairly. He died without children to continue his family. He was put to death. He was punished for the sins of my people.
He was buried with wicked men. He died with the rich. He had done nothing wrong. He had never lied.
Thank you.
Isaiah 53, verses 10 through 12. But it was the Lord who decided to crush him and make him suffer. So the Lord made his life a penalty offering. But he will see his descendants and live a long life. He will complete the things the Lord wants him to do.
He will suffer many things in his soul, but then he will see life and be satisfied. My good servant will make many people right with God. He carried away their sins.
For this reason, I will make him a great man among people. He will share in all things with those who are strong. He willingly gave his life. He was treated like a criminal, but he carried away the sins of many people, and he asked forgiveness for those who sinned.
With one sacrifice, he made perfect forever those who are being made holy.
Receive God's blessing. I invite you to stand. May you find in the cross a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and the assurance of sins forgiven. And may the blessing of God go with you now and forevermore. Amen.
shadow of death. It was about noon, and the whole land became dark until 3 o'clock in the afternoon. There was no sun. The curtain in the temple was torn into two pieces. Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Father, I give you my life." After Jesus said this, he died.
The centurion, seeing what had happened, praised God and said, "Surely this was a righteous man."
Many people had gathered there to watch this thing. When they saw what had happened, they returned home. They beat their chests because they were so sad. Those who were close friends of Jesus were there. Some were women who had followed Jesus from Galilee. They all stood far away from the cross and watched.
Sometimes it causes me to tremble.